Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Final Chapters, How Famous Authors Died, by Jim Bernhard. Narrated by Daniel Henning. Last Words First, an Introduction. When we hear that anyone has died, one of the first things we ask is, what did he or she die of? And then, how old was he or she? Such personal details of death are a source of fascination to most people. Dorothy L. Sayers, who killed off a good many folks in her murder mysteries, said, "Death seems to provide the minds of the Anglo-Saxon race with a greater fund of amusement than any other single subject." But she didn't go far enough in her assessment. It's not just Anglo-Saxons who are stuck on death, it's the whole human race. Death has several characteristics that may explain the attention that we lavish on it. It is both inevitable, so far as we know, and unpredictable, in most circumstances. People who estimate such things tell us that since the beginning of the world, about 107 billion people have been born. Of that total, only a little more than 7 billion are alive today. If you do the math, you'll find that means that out of everyone who's ever lived, 93% of them have died. The odds are not in favor of the remaining 7% of us. The Pulitzer Prize-winning writer William Saroyan once said, "Everybody has got to die, but I've always believed an exception would be made in my case." Unfortunately for him, no exception was made, and he died of prostate cancer in 1981. He was 72. Inevitable as it may be, death is also unpredictable for most of us as to precisely when we might expect it. This quality infuses it with a suspenseful frisson, guaranteeing that we will think about it from time to time. Nobody has expressed the inevitability of death better than William Shakespeare. Hamlet, who pondered the subject more than was good for him, put it this way: "There is a special providence in the fall of a sparrow. If it be now, 'tis not to come. If it be not to come, it will be now. If it be not now, yet it will come. The readiness is all." One other quality that gives death a healthy dose of gravitas is its finality. No matter what one's views are about the possibility of an afterlife, there's no getting around the fact that death permanently ends the life we're in now, the only one we really know anything about. The lane to the land of the dead, as W.H. Auden called it, is a one-way street. And its destination, as Hamlet puts it, is the undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveler returns. The lives and deaths of the world's poets, dramatists, and novelists are ideal for studying how humans approach dying. The various ways they shuffled off this mortal coil could fill an encyclopedia of disease and mishap. They were snuffed out by infections, especially in the days before antibiotics, by frequent lung disease, particularly in the 19th century when tuberculosis and pneumonia were rampant, by the expected quotient of heart attacks, strokes, and cancer, by stomach and kidney disorders and a few rare and unknown diseases, plus a fair number of suicides, murders, assassinations, and bizarre accidents. Alcohol, tobacco, and narcotics played leading roles in many cases. Death came to some in startling ways. The Greek playwright Aeschylus had a fatal encounter with a turtle that fell from the sky. Italian theologian Thomas Aquinas was knocked off a donkey by a tree branch and never recovered. French dramatist Moliere was mortally stricken while playing the part of a hypochondriac in one of his own plays. The corpse of the philosophe Voltaire was transported to his funeral dressed in finery and propped up as if he were still alive. American poet Emily Dickinson's final illness was difficult to diagnose, because rather than allowing her doctor to examine her, all she would consent to was to walk slowly past the open door of his examining room while he observed her from inside. Writer Sherwood Anderson was felled by an errant toothpick in a martini. Trappist monk Thomas Merton was killed by a fan, an electric one. Did poet Dylan Thomas really die of 18 straight whiskeys? And was it a stray bottle cap, too many pills and too much liquor, or murder most foul that did in playwright Tennessee Williams? Ages of authors at the time of death have also varied widely. Curiously, even though average life expectancies have substantially lengthened in modern times, writers do not seem to have benefited from the improvement. The average age of death of the classic Greek and Roman subjects in this book was about 70. Oddly enough, for the authors of the 20th and 21st centuries, it was earlier, about 65. Ages at death range from Sophocles at 91 and George Bernard Shaw at 94 to Percy Bysshe Shelley at 29 and John Keats at only 25. This book explores not only the individual causes of death and the circumstances surrounding it, but also what each author might have thought about the end of life. Being writers, most have left at least some clues, if not specific exposition, about their attitudes toward death in their poems, plays, novels, diaries, letters, and interviews. They exhibit a wide range of opinions. Few, if any, of these famous authors have had the kind of near-death experiences that have spawned many recent sensational books that often climb to the top of bestseller lists. The array of such alluring titles is dizzying. Proof of Heaven, Return from Tomorrow, My Descent into Death, 90 Minutes in Heaven, Life on the Other Side, Waking Up in Heaven, and Heaven is for Real, are a few of them. One classic author who stands out as an anomaly for his unwavering certainty about the existence of an afterlife is Arthur Conan Doyle, Sherlock Holmes' creator, who insisted that he was able to converse with folks who had passed over to the other side. For the most part, however, the creators of our literature, from the classical era to modern times, have expressed the same kind of uncertainty the rest of us feel about what to expect from a visit by the Grim Reaper. Like anyone else's, the author's views about death are shaped by their religious and philosophical beliefs, which span the gamut from polytheism and Stoicism in the classical Greco-Roman period to Christianity, prevalent in the European Middle Ages and Renaissance, to deist and transcendental thought, developed in France and America in the 18th and 19th centuries, to the questioning agnosticism or blatant atheism that pervades the contemporary age of anxiety. Attitudes towards death differ widely, ranging from fear to acceptance to indifference. The selection of authors may strike some as arbitrary, and it is. It is based on purely personal preferences, appearing in a chronological sequence by date of birth. Despite glaring omissions or idiosyncratic inclusions, the list does represent an approximation of what might be found in a history of Western lit. The historical arrangement of the authors is purely for the convenience of the listener. The periods have been divided into classical, medieval, Renaissance, Enlightenment, Romantic, Victorian, and modern, generally following the usual pattern of literature courses. As for historical documentation, this is not a textbook or a reference work and should not be held to strict academic standards. Other than quotations from the works of the authors themselves, sources include online and printed encyclopedias, including but not limited to the invaluable Wikipedia.org, literary websites, biographies, biographical directories, diaries, news accounts, principally nytimes.com, telegraph.co.uk, theguardian.com, dailymail.co.uk, bbc.co.uk. The especially useful websites nndb.com, biography.com, poets.org, poetryfoundation.org, poetsgraves.co.uk, poemhunter.com, books.google.com, schmoop.com, and the always fascinating findadeath.com and findagrave.com. They went that-a-way, by Malcolm Forbes also provided a number of informative tips. While reasonable effort has been made to verify facts, details are nonetheless incomplete and should not be relied upon as having encyclopedic authority. Where there have been differing accounts of the circumstances of an author's death, I have favored the most interesting, or lurid, version, but have also indicated that opinions vary. As always, I am grateful for the encouragement and almost all of the criticism of my devoted wife, Virginia, a historian, whose suggestions have attempted in vain to disguise the inadequacies of this volume with a patina of scholarly methods. I must also acknowledge with gratitude the counsel and assistance of Julia Lord, my savvy, gracious, and indefatigable agent. My thanks also go to Nicole Frail, my editor at Skyhorse Publishing. If there are lessons to be learned from the words of the authors in this book, the best one is probably that of Marcus Aurelius. Death smiles at us all. All we can do is smile back. The Classical Age. Aeschylus. If plays had been rated in ancient Athens as movies are today, the tragedies of Aeschylus would have earned an R for violence, incestuous sex, cannibalism, and gory deaths. You be the judge. In the Oresteia trilogy, lurid details tell of Agamemnon's bloody murder of his own daughter while she's bound and gagged, the subsequent butchery and dismemberment of Agamemnon along with his paramour Cassandra by his vengeful wife Clytemnestra, more revenge perpetrated by their son Orestes, who, with the help of his sister Electra, fatally stabs Clytemnestra and her lover, Aegisthus. Oh, and don't forget Aegisthus's father, Thyestes, who murdered his half-brother and slept with the wife of his brother, Atreus, who then got even by killing Thyestes' sons, roasting them and feeding them to their unwitting father. Thyestes then raped his own daughter, who gave birth to Aegisthus, who killed Atreus. Phew! And that's only three of the 90 or so plays that Aeschylus wrote. It's too bad for slasher fans that only seven of the 90 have been found. First of the three great tragic Greek playwrights, Aeschylus himself was apparently a very gentle and scholarly fellow, born about 525 BC into a wealthy family in Eleusis, 25 miles northwest of Athens. He grew up devoutly religious, believing in the Greek pantheon of gods, who were often cruel and violent. He was initiated into the secret cult of Demeter, known as the Eleusinian Mysteries. With his brother, Aeschylus fought in the Battle of Marathon, in which the Greeks defeated the invading Persians under King Darius. His brother died in the battle, but Aeschylus lived to do military duty once again against the Persians, this time led by King Xerxes at the Battle of Salamis 10 years later. This battle is memorialized in his play, The Persians. Murder may have been a horror to Aeschylus, but death itself was a natural and sometimes desirable culmination of life. "Death is a gentler fate than tyranny," he wrote in Agamemnon. There is fame for one who nobly meets his death with honor. In that play, the unfortunate Cassandra contemplates her brutal demise with equanimity. "I willingly endure my death and warmly greet the gates of Hades that open for me. Grant me, you gods, a clean blow and an easy fall free from agony. Let my blood flow smoothly from my veins so that I may close my eyes in peaceful death." Aeschylus's own death was nothing he would have written a play about. He met his end unexpectedly in the year 456 BC at the age of 68 or 69 in a bizarre mishap while visiting the island of Sicily. According to Pliny the Elder in his Natural History, Aeschylus had been warned by an oracle that he would be killed by a house falling on him. Accordingly, he spent as much time as possible in the open, far from any edifices that might collapse. He was taking an ostensibly healthful stroll in the fresh sea air when what was said to be an eagle, more likely a vulture, dropped a turtle on his glistening bald head, which the not-so-eagle-eyed bird mistook for a rock. Bearded vultures, or lammergeier, Gypaetius barbatus, are known to pick up box turtles, Testudo graica, and drop them from great heights onto large rocks with remarkable accuracy in order to get at the juicy meat and bones inside. The turtle house that was dropped on Aeschylus reportedly remained intact, but alas, the old playwright's head did not. Aeschylus was buried on the island in a grave that bore an epitaph that he had composed for himself. In this tomb, in the wheat fields of Gela, lies Aeschylus of Athens, son of Euphorion. He fought in the hallowed precincts of Marathon, which can speak of his valor, which is remembered as well by the long-haired Persians. Aeschylus was survived by two sons, who were also dramatists. One of them, Euphorion, won first prize at the City Dionysia play competition in 431 BC, defeating both Sophocles and Euripides. Even though they didn't win on this occasion, those two were the true heirs of Aeschylus's dramatic legacy. Sophocles. Waiting eagerly in the wings, Sophocles was about 40 years old when Aeschylus died. Born into a wealthy family about 497 BC in Colonus, he was incredibly prolific, turning out more than 125 plays. Like those of Aeschylus, however, most have vanished, and only seven survive, notably Antigone, Oedipus Rex, and Oedipus at Colonus. Sophocles' first big success came when he was barely 30. He took first prize at the Dionysia, besting the veteran Aeschylus, who left Athens in a huff shortly thereafter and went to Sicily. Active in Athenian politics, Sophocles served in several civic positions, including city treasurer, general of the army, and priest. Constantly busy, he was known as the Bee of Athens. He was married twice and had two sons. Sophocles held a conventional ancient Greek view of death as a liberation from life's hardships. Antigone tells Creon she would welcome death as a blessing. "I know I must die, even without your edicts. But if I am to die before my time, I count that as a gain. For when one lives as I do, surrounded by evils, what could death bring but gain? So for me to meet this doom is but a trifling grief." For Sophocles, as for most Greeks, the greatest possible good was to live out one's life without encountering the kind of tragic events that filled his plays. As the chorus at the end of Oedipus Rex observes, "This was Oedipus the Great. Upon him all the world would gaze with envious eyes. But now a sea of trouble overwhelms him. Thus we must wait until the day of death, which comes upon us all, and count no man among the blessed until his journey ends, without calamity befalling him." Sophocles basked among the blessed until he died at the age of 90 or 91 in the winter of 406-405 BC. There are several stories about the cause of death. Most famous is that he died from excessive strain while trying to recite a long sentence from Antigone without pausing to take a breath. Another account says he choked on a mouthful of grapes at an Athenian festival. And some of his admirers maintained that he succumbed to sheer happiness after winning his final victory at the city Dionysia. There is the possibility that he died of plain old senility, since his sons allegedly tried to have him declared incompetent shortly before the end of his life. Sophocles was buried in a family tomb, no longer extant, on the road between Athens and Decelea. After his death, the comic playwright Phrynichus, in a play titled The Muses, wrote this elegy: "Blessed is Sophocles, who had a long life, was a man both happy and talented, and the writer of many good tragedies, and he ended his life well without suffering any misfortune. Euripides. Playwrights were adulated like Olympic athletes in ancient Athens, and the next gold medalist was Euripides. He wrote about 95 tragedies, and 18 of them survive, among them Medea, Orestes, Electra, the Trojan Women, Helen of Troy, Iphigenia in Tauris, Andromache, and the Bacchae. From a middle-class merchant family, Euripides was born sometime between 485 and 480 BC on the Greek island of Salamis, about 16 miles from Athens. He grew up as a skeptic, a humanist who believed, like the philosopher Protagoras, that man is the measure of all things. Euripides' plays use some of the same mythological material as those of Aeschylus, but the action depends more on human psychology than on what the gods decree. Some people thought the philosopher Socrates helped him write them, and like Socrates, Euripides was accused of being an irreverent firebrand. He put into the mouth of Medea words that he probably thought applied to himself. If you express new ideas among fools, they regard you as a trifling ignoramus. And if you happen to become more famous than the so-called intelligentsia, they will really hate you. That has been my misfortune. Some people think I am clever and they resent me. Others think I'm stupid and they scorn me. Euripides relished his role as an iconoclast, and the prospect of his own death can only have been regarded as an unwelcome interruption of his productive life. True to conventional Greek beliefs, his Medea, learning that she has been abandoned by her husband Jason, longs for death as an escape. How I wish a lightning bolt from heaven would split my head in two. What good is there in life for me? None. There's nothing but woe. Oh, let me die and be released from this horrid existence. Not so fast, says the chorus in what seems to be Euripides' own voice. Oh, you reckless one, why do you long for that eternal rest that comes only with death? There's no need to pray for it. It will arrive soon enough. Never accorded as much acclaim as his illustrious predecessors enjoyed, Euripides won Athens' top prize for tragedy only 4 times, compared with 13 for Aeschylus and 20 for Sophocles. He was also unlucky at love, and both his wives left him for other men. He became a recluse, making a home for himself in a cave on Salamis. In 408, at the invitation of King Archelaus, he moved to Macedon and lived there in another cave, happy as a clam, until he died. How he died is a mystery. Owing to his unsympathetic female characters like Medea, Phaedra, and Helen, Euripides gained a reputation as a woman-hater, and one legend says a group of angry women did him in. Another story says he was torn apart by wild dogs while walking home from an evening festival. Probably he died in his cave around 406 BC, in his late 70s, of natural causes, exacerbated by the frigid winter weather of Macedon. Euripides was buried in Macedon near an Athenian settlement in the valley of Arethusa. A memorial inscription reads, "All Greece is the monument of Euripides. The Macedonian earth covers only his bones, for it was there that his life reached its end. His homeland is Athens, the Greece of all Greece. He gave much delight through his muse and is greatly esteemed." Socrates. A troublemaker and proud of it. Socrates technically wasn't an author at all, since the only surviving accounts of his ideas were written by his famous pupil, Plato. Born in Athens in 469 BC, Socrates came from a middle-class family. His father was either a stonemason, sculptor, or woodworker, or maybe all three, and his mother was a midwife. Known around Athens as a philosopher and teacher who delighted in paradoxical questioning that proved embarrassing to the powers that be, he married a woman named Xanthippe, who was as argumentative as he was. When he stood trial at the age of 70, he was charged with impiety against the religion of the state and of corrupting the minds of young people. Something of a smart aleck, he defended his role as a gadfly by suggesting that his punishment should be a handsome salary and free dinners for the rest of his life. "Not a chance," said his judges, and instead sentenced him to death by drinking hemlock, a highly poisonous, perennial, herbaceous flowering plant native to the Mediterranean region. It disrupts the central nervous system, and even small doses result in muscular paralysis, causing respiratory failure and death. That fate didn't faze Socrates. His views on death and the serene manner in which he approached his own end are well chronicled in several of Plato's dialogues. In the Apology, Socrates observes, "To fear death, gentlemen, is to think oneself wise when one is not, to think one knows what one does not know. As far as anyone knows, death may be the greatest of all blessings, yet people fear it as if they knew for certain that it is the greatest of evils." Socrates was condemned by a vote of 281 to 220. Plato tells us that as he was taken away to prison, he told his judges, "The hour of departure has arrived, and now we go our separate ways, I to die and you to live. Which is better, only God knows." This account of Socrates' final moments is from Plato's Phaedo. "In what way shall we bury you?" asked his friend Crito. "Any way you like," replied Socrates, "but first you have to catch me. Be careful that I do not run away from you. You think the dead body you will soon see is the same Socrates standing here talking. But when I have drunk the poison, I shall leave you all and go to the joys of the blessed. So be of good cheer then, Crito, and remember that you are not burying Socrates, you're only burying my body. Now, we'd better get the poison ready." Crito said, "It's early. We can wait a little while." Socrates answered, "I do not think that I would gain anything by waiting. I would only seem ridiculous to myself for trying to squeeze out a few more minutes from a life that is already forfeit. So please, get the poison." The jailer came with the poison, and Socrates said, "You're experienced in these matters. What am I supposed to do?" The man answered, "Just walk about until your legs are heavy and then lie down, and the poison will do the rest." "I understand," Socrates said. "Now I ask the gods to give me a prosperous journey from this to the other world." Then he cheerfully drank all the poison. His friends began to weep. "What are you doing?" said Socrates. "Please, just be quiet. A man should be allowed to die in peace." He walked about until he said his legs began to fail, and then he lay on his back. The jailer pressed his foot hard and asked him if he could feel, and he said, "No, nothing. When the poison reaches my heart, that will be the end." In a while, he began to grow cold about the groin. Suddenly, he turned to Crito and reminded him to offer a rooster to Aeschylus, the god of healing, in thanks for delivering him from a painful life. "Of course," said Crito. "Anything else?" But Socrates did not answer, and they noted that his eyes were fixed. Such was the end of our friend, who was the wisest and best and most just man of his time. Plato. Plato's real name was Aristocles, which in Greek means highest glory. He was a hefty lad whose wrestling coach gave him the nickname Plato, meaning broad-shouldered. It must have suited him better than his real name, since that's how he has been known ever since. Born in 428 BC in Athens to a politically connected family, Plato did a stint in the army and then, as a civilian, he became a devoted follower of Socrates. In 387, he founded a school in Athens that he called the Academy. Among his prize pupils was Aristotle, who studied there for 20 years, beginning in 367. A prolific writer, Plato left a number of dialogues and epistles, including the Apology, Crito, the Republic, Phaedo, the Symposium, the Parmenides, the Sophist, and the Laws. He is the principal chronicler of the life of Socrates and the main source of his mentor's teachings. Plato was not bashful in expressing views on a number of political, artistic, and metaphysical subjects, including death. In the Symposium, he recounts the legendary Greek warrior Aeschylus' heroic death, seemingly with approval. Aeschylus was quite aware that he might avoid death and return home and live to a good old age if he abstained from slaying Hector. Nevertheless, he gave his life to revenge his friend and dared to die. For this, the gods honored him and sent him to the islands of the blessed. These are my reasons for affirming that love is the noblest and mightiest of the gods and the chief author of virtue in life and of happiness after death. Plato likely believed that the eternal human soul is in a constant cycle, trapped in a human body and then escaping the body at death to return to the realm of the forms, then back to a human body, and so on ad infinitum. In Timaeus, he paints a picture of a pleasant natural death, as opposed to the pain of a violent one. Plato writes, "In a natural death, the soul flies away with joy, for that which takes place according to nature is pleasant, but that which is contrary to nature is painful. And thus, death, if caused by disease or produced by wounds, is painful and violent. But that sort of death which comes with old age and fulfills the debt of nature is the easiest of deaths, and is accompanied with pleasure rather than with pain." Plato's death in 347 BC at the age of 81 was of the pleasant variety. In his treatise on old age, the Roman poet Cicero characterizes Plato's final years as a tranquil and serene evening of a life spent in peaceful, blameless, enlightened pursuits. According to a popular account, a Thracian girl played the flute for Plato on the evening of his death. Untrained as a musician, the girl didn't get the tempo right, so Plato began to conduct the piece as she played. He then drifted peacefully into death, music ringing in his ears. Another tale says he dropped dead at a wedding feast, presumably while having a jolly time. Never married, Plato willed the academy to his sister's son, Speusippus, and it survived as an institution of learning for nearly 1,000 years. Aristotle, third in the philosophical succession from Socrates to Plato, characterized by Dante as the master of those who know, was born in 384 BC in Stagira Chalcide, which is about 55 miles east of the present-day Greek city of Thessalonica. His name supposedly means highest purpose, which gives you an idea of what his parents had in mind for him. His father, the personal physician to King Amyntas II of Macedon, was named Nicomachus. Aristotle's parents both died when he was young, and he was brought up by an uncle named Praxinus. At the age of 18, he was sent to study in Athens at Plato's Academy, where he remained for 20 years. Then, after Plato's death, he opened his own school, which he called the Lyceum. Aristotle wrote extensively about politics, ethics, metaphysics, and poetics. Aristotle was married to Pythias, the foster daughter of his friend and patron Hermias, king of the Greek city-state of Atarneus. They had a daughter named Pythias for her mother. After his wife's death, her servant, Herpolis became Aristotle's live-in mistress, and they had a son, Nicomachus, to whom Aristotle dedicated his famous philosophical work, the Nicomachean Ethics. When Aristotle was in his early 40s, he was invited by King Philip of Macedon to become the tutor of his son, Prince Alexander, better known as Alexander the Great. Teacher and pupil didn't always see eye to eye, and at one point Alexander accused Aristotle of wanting to assassinate him and threatened him with execution. Aristotle skedaddled back to Athens. When Alexander died in 323, after a prolonged drinking binge, Athenians were eager to rid themselves of any vestige of the hated Macedonians. Because of his association with Alexander, Aristotle was accused of some of the same crimes that Socrates had been charged with, and rather than stick around to see if he would meet the same fate, Aristotle got out of town fast, saying, "I will not allow the Athenians to sin twice against philosophy." He retired to his mother's family estate in Macedon, where he died shortly thereafter at the tender age of 62, from a stomach ailment, perhaps ulcers, that he suffered from much of his life. There is no evidence for either of two stories that were circulated after his death, that he killed himself with hemlock in tribute to Socrates, or that he threw himself into the sea because he could not explain the motion of the tides. Aristotle believed that soul and body were inseparable, the soul being a component of the body, keeping it alive and enriching it in much the same way as blood does. When the body died, so did the soul. While Aristotle did allow for the possibility of the immortality of the intellect, it is doubtful that he meant an individual personal intellect. In the Nicomachean Ethics, he wrote, "Death is the most terrible of all things, for it is the end, and nothing is any longer thought to be either good or bad for the dead." Virgil. "Arms and the man I sing" are the ringing opening lines of Virgil's Aeneid, the epic poem that celebrates the voyage of the Trojan prince Aeneas to Italy after the fall of Troy and his founding of what was to become the Roman Empire. Virgil himself, or Publius Virgilius Maro, to use his full name, was far from being the kind of military hero he extols in his poem. Today, he might be called a dweeb or a nerd, a virtual recluse, shy and sickly with digestive problems throughout his life. Born in Ondes, Cisalpine Gaul, in what is now Lombardy, Italy, on October 15, 70 BC, he came from a family of landowners. After attending school in several Italian cities, he devoted himself to poetry, turning out the pastoral Eclogues and Georgics before writing his masterpiece, the Aeneid. Very much a loner and never married, Virgil was probably a Stoic, basically materialist in his worldview with no clear notion of an afterlife. He seemed to approve of the prevailing sentiment of the time that it would be noble to die in battle, as expressed by Aeneas, his Trojan hero, in John Dryden's sonorous translation. "Thrice and four times happy those," he cried, "that under Ilian walls before their parents died, Tydides, bravest of the Grecian train. Why could not I by that strong arm be slain, and lie by noble Hector on the plain, or great Sarpedon in those bloody fields, where Simoï rolls the bodies and the shields of heroes whose dismembered hands yet bear the dart aloft and clinch the pointed spear." Virgil journeyed to Greece in 19 BC, hoping to find the inspiration to revise some parts of the Aeneid. While there, he met his friend and patron, the Emperor Augustus, who was also visiting Athens. On his way back to Rome, Virgil came down with a fever, possibly a symptom of tuberculosis. He made it back to Italy, but only as far as Brundisium, where he died on September 21st at the age of 50. Unable to complete his revisions of the Aeneid, he had left instructions for it to be burned. But Augustus, with an emperor's prerogative and a shrewd literary hunch, overrode his wishes and ordered it published anyway. Hail Caesar! Horace. The Roman poet Horace, born on December 8, 65 BC, in Venusia, a military colony in southeast Italy, was named Quintus Horatius Flaccus, which means limp or feeble, or maybe flap-eared Horace the Fifth. What his parents had in mind with that label is anybody's guess. As an adult, he was known to be short, fat, and prematurely gray-haired. No wonder he took his pleasures when and where he could find them. According to the reliably gossipy historian Suetonius, Horace was a notorious hedonist who was addicted to pornographic pictures and had mirrors installed in his bedroom. It was Horace, in one of his odes, who coined the phrase carpe diem, usually translated as seize the day. He was educated at Rome's finest school and joined the army, unfortunately ending up on the wrong side of the Battle of Philippi, where Mark Antony and Octavian defeated Brutus, for whom Horace fought. Amnesty was granted all around by the new Emperor Octavian, soon to be Augustus, so Horace was able to find a government job and start writing poetry. His satires, his epistles, and his odes became quite popular, and Horace obtained the patronage of Maecenas, one of Augustus's chief advisors. Maecenas lavished Horace with gifts, one of which was an estate in the Sabine Hills, where Horace enjoyed a leisurely life, often sleeping until 10 o'clock in the morning. Suetonius reports that Horace, who never married, led a vigorous sex life in his mirrored bedroom. There were reports that he enjoyed having partners of both genders. Horace apparently accepted the traditional Roman religion, but devoted little speculative thought to the meaning of life and death, either in his works or in his private life. He claimed to have been startled out of his atheism when he heard a clap of thunder in a cloudless sky. His poems embody a conventional belief in the gods to whom he gives due respect, but for whom there is little evident devotion. In early November of 8 BC, Maecenas died, and Horace rushed to his patron's villa in Rome, where he himself died suddenly 3 weeks later, on November 27th, just 12 days before his 57th birthday. Some speculated that he died of grief at the loss of Maecenas, or possibly even committed suicide in order to follow him in death. It is more likely that Horace succumbed to a heart attack or stroke. However he died, it must have been unexpected. While he had begun to draft a will in which he left all his belongings to the Emperor Augustus, as was expected of Augustus's friends, he didn't live long enough to complete the document. Horace is buried near Maecenas on the Esquiline Hill in Rome. Ovid, the enormously popular Roman poet whose Metamorphoses is one of the most influential works of Western literature, spent the last decade of his life as an exile in a bleak and remote Black Sea community in what is now Romania, where the winters were bitter cold, savage Cossack barbarians made periodic raids, and no one spoke Latin. Why one of Rome's leading lights wound up in the boondocks is anybody's guess. A poem and a mistake is the cryptic reason Ovid gave for his mysterious banishment by Augustus Caesar in 8 AD. The poem in question was undoubtedly Ars Amatoria, The Art of Love, a racy bit of erotica that might well have required punishment from an emperor supposedly dedicated to restoring public morality. But the mistake, which Ovid would say only was worse than murder and more harmful than poetry, remains unknown. Most likely it was some form of lèse majesté, a personal offense against the emperor, possibly the discovery of Augustus in incestuous flagrante delicto with his own daughter. Be that as it may, Ovid was not a happy camper during the last years of his life. Born on March 20th, 43 BC, in Abruzzo, in central Italy, Ovid is best known for the Metamorphoses, a compendium of mythological transformations, which provided source material for such later authors as Dante, Chaucer, Boccaccio, Spenser, and Shakespeare. He's also noted for his love poetry, particularly the Ars Amatoria and Amoris. In the Ars Amatoria, Ovid shows not only his cynical take on romance, but also an insouciant view of the role the gods play in human life. Promise women anything. Women love promises. And be sure to swear by all the gods that you'll be true to your word. Jupiter will just look down and laugh at your lies and toss them to Aeschylus for the winds to play with. He used to make the same kind of promises to Juno, down by the river Styx, when he swore he'd be faithful. And you know how well he kept those promises. So take courage from his example. It's a good thing to believe in the gods and to bring offerings of wine and incense to their altars. You would do well to observe the precepts of religion. Don't lie to anybody, except, of course, women, for that doesn't count. It's little wonder that Ovid was divorced twice before he was 30. His third wife, however, was a keeper, and she thought the same of him, for she stuck by him during his exile. Ovid's poetry turned bitter during his years away from Rome. In his writings, he complains of a harsh climate, a general weakness in his body, insomnia, loss of weight and appetite, pallor, a parched tongue, a pain in the side attributed to the winter cold, trembling hands, deep wrinkles, senility, delirium, and depression. These ailments finally caught up with him in the harsh winter of 17 AD when Ovid died at the age of 60. He was buried a few kilometers away in a town that was renamed Ovidiu in his honor in 1930. Marcus Aurelius. Death is a release from the impressions of the senses, from the desires that make us their puppets, from the vagaries of the mind, and from the hard service of the flesh, wrote Marcus Aurelius in his Meditations. The future Roman emperor was to the manner born. His parents were both members of the ruling patrician class, in Rome on April 26, 121 AD. As a young man, he was a serious student, devoted to the teachings of the Greek Stoic philosopher Epictetus. Marcus's early life would make a good soap opera. He came to the attention of the Emperor Hadrian, who arranged for him to be adopted by Antoninus, who was next in line to be emperor. Antoninus, who had another adoptive son, known as Verus, succeeded to the throne in 138. Marcus continued his studies, married Antoninus's daughter, Faustina, and served as consul, the leader of the Senate. In 161, Antoninus died and Marcus shared the throne with his adoptive brother until Verus's death in 169, after which Marcus ruled alone. Marcus Aurelius is most remembered for his philosophical meditations, rooted in Stoic philosophy, many of which deal with the meaning of death, characterized as a welcome and natural part of life. Despise not death, but welcome it, for nature wills it like all else, he wrote. Live a good life. If there are gods and they are just, then they will not care how devout you've been, but will welcome you based on the virtues you've lived by. If there are gods, but unjust, then you should not want to worship them. If there are no gods, then you will be gone, but you will have lived a noble life that will live on in the memories of your loved ones. Perhaps his final word on the subject is this wry observation. Death smiles at us all. All we can do is smile back. Marcus Aurelius, smiling or not, met his death in 180, when he was 59, near what is now Vienna. He had been ill for some time with an unknown ailment, possibly cancer, and is thought to have died of an infection. There were tales that he had died of the plague brought back from Parthia by his army, or from lead poisoning in the water pipes, or that his son, Commodius, hastened his departure by administering poison. But these suppositions are all without evidence. Marcus is buried in the mausoleum of Hadrian at Castel Sant'Angelo in Rome. The Middle Ages. Augustine of Hippo. Augustine of Hippo, known in many Christian churches as Saint Augustine or sometimes Saint Austin, was no saint as a young man. Born in 354 in Tagaste, a now vanished city on the site of what is now Souk Ahras, Algeria, he was a pleasure-seeking playboy who lived in the fast lane until his mid-30s. A professor of rhetoric, first in Carthage and later in Rome and Milan, he had a mistress in Carthage, with whom he sired a son named Adeodatus. And there were other paramours in Milan. He was noted for a prayer in which he asked God, "Give me chastity, but not yet." His mother, a devout Christian convert named Monica, took a dim view of Augustine's debauchery and tried for years to convert her son. He went through a series of philosophical attachments, Manichaeism, skepticism, and Neoplatonism, before renouncing his hedonistic life and adopting Christianity. He later became a bishop in the city of Hippo, Algeria, a revered father of the church, and the author of several notable works on theology, which include The City of God and The Confessions. Augustine held carefully reasoned and theologically detailed ideas about what happens to people after death, stemming from his reading of the Bible and from traditional Catholic teaching. He was noted for expounding the doctrine of amillennialism, the belief that Christ was now reigning in a symbolic thousand-year period that would be followed at world's end by final judgment and the establishment of a permanent kingdom of God. Augustine taught that the eternal fate of the soul is determined at death, and that the fires of purgatory purify those who die in communion with the church but are still tainted by sin. Augustine's death came at the age of 76, on August 28, 430, of a virulent fever, aggravated by stress and malnutrition, which he suffered 3 months into a siege of the city of Hippo by the German tribe known as Vandals. The Vandals kept Hippo under attack for 14 months, and 25 years later, ensuring their name would be known for centuries to come, the same bunch sacked Rome, leading to the fall of the Roman Empire. Augustine's remains were buried first in the Hippo Cathedral, but when Catholic bishops were expelled from northern Africa by the Vandal ruler Hunneric in 484, they took Augustine's bones with them to Cagliari in Sardinia. About 720, the remains were acquired by the Bishop of Pavia, Italy, who deposited them in Pavia's Church of San Pietro, in Ciel d'Oro, where they now reside. Thomas Aquinas. Nicknamed Dumb Sicilian Ox by his fellow monks, Thomas Aquinas was heavyset, hardworking, and slow to speak. But when he had something to say, he bellowed. Born January 28, 1225, into a well-connected family in Aquino County, Sicily, Thomas was the youngest son of Landulf of Aquino, a Milus, or knight, and Dame Theodora, whose family were minor aristocrats in Naples. He was destined for monastic life from age 5 when he was sent to study at the Benedictine Abbey of Monte Cassino, where his uncle had been abbot. At 19, he joined the upstart Dominican order, to the chagrin of his pro-Benedictine family, who went so far as to kidnap him to try to dissuade him, but to no avail. Ensconced among the Dominicans, Thomas wrote numerous carefully reasoned theological works, the most famous of which, Summa Theologica, sometimes Theologiae, and Summa Contra Gentilis, still form the basis of much Roman Catholic thought. On December 6th, 1273, when he was 48 years old, he was observed in the chapel of the Dominican monastery at Naples, levitating and having a conversation with an icon of the crucified Christ. "What would you have as a reward for your labor?" Christ supposedly said. "Nothing but you, Lord," said Thomas. After this episode, which was either a mystical epiphany or a stroke, Thomas never wrote another line, telling his secretary, "I cannot, for all that I have written before seems like straw compared to what has been revealed to me." Thomas's view of life after death was the Orthodox Catholic view of reward and punishment in heaven, hell, and purgatory, a view that he himself helped to shape. In Summa Theologica, he wrote, "The soul becomes separated from its mortal body, and its merits determine whether it receives the consequences of good or of evil. Therefore, after death, the soul either receives or is denied a final reward. The state of final retribution is twofold. For the good, it is paradise. For the evil, because of unforgiven faults, it is hell. If, however, the soul is in a state that prevents it from receiving its final reward because of minor sins that have been committed, it is detained in purgatory, where souls may expiate those faults and defects that detract from the glory of human nature until they are ready to obtain their reward." In 1274, Pope Gregory X summoned Thomas to take part in a council in Lyon on May 1st, and in January he set out from Naples, a distance of some 600 miles, on foot and by donkey. Along the Appian Way, Thomas hit his head on a tree branch and was knocked off the donkey. He was taken to the nearby monastery of Monte Cassino to recuperate. He set out once more, but fell ill again, this time stopping at the castle of his niece, Countess Francesca Ciccano. After a few days, he felt no better and asked to be moved to the Cistercian Abbey of Fossanova, 6 miles away. "If the Lord wishes to take me," he said, "it's better that he find me in a holy monastery than in a layperson's castle." Thomas was given last rites by the monks, received the Eucharist, and with remarkable stamina and syntactical precision for a dying man, offered this lengthy prayer: "If in this world there be any knowledge of this sacrament stronger than that of faith, I wish now to use it in affirming that I firmly believe and know as certain that Jesus Christ, true God and true man, Son of God and Son of the Virgin Mary, is in this sacrament. I receive thee, the price of my redemption, for whose love I have watched, studied, and labored. Thee have I preached, thee have I taught. Never have I said anything against thee. If anything was not well said, that is to be attributed to my ignorance. Neither do I wish to be obstinate in my opinions, but if I have written anything erroneous concerning this sacrament or other matters, I submit all to the judgment and correction of the Holy Roman Church, in whose obedience I now pass from this life." He died on March 7th, 1274, at the age of 49. The poet Dante Alighieri, in his Inferno, claimed that Thomas had been poisoned, possibly by a fellow monk, or a knight, or a physician, on the orders of King Charles of Anjou, with whom Thomas was at odds politically. Thomas's body was given to the Dominican order, and today most of it is in a gold and silver sarcophagus in the church of Saint-Sernin in Toulouse, France, except his right arm, which is in the church of Santa Maria Sopra Minerva in Rome, and a bone from his left arm, which is preserved as a relic in the Cathedral of Naples. canonized in 1323, St. Thomas, now rests in pieces. Dante Alighieri. Dante Alighieri had a lifelong obsession with a young woman he saw only twice in his life. Best remembered for his epic poem, The Divine Comedy, Dante was born in Florence, Italy, around 1265. His family were Guelphs, members of a political party that supported the papacy in a power struggle with the German emperor, and this affiliation would later cause him much grief. Dante married Gemma de Minato Donati, and they had four children. But the love of his life, at least in his own mind, was Beatrice Portinari, whom he met for the first time at a May Day party at her house when he was 9 years old and she was eight. Their second and last meeting was a chance encounter 9 years later on a Florence street. Beatrice remained a fixation with him, and he wrote extensively of her in his autobiography.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.